I've spent so much time at camp over the past 12 years of my life that I don't really know who I would be had I not come to camp for all these years. So, I mean, I guess I'd say that camp is who I am. I think it's allowed me to show who I truly am, because as you become closer and closer to people, you start to open up and show what your true traits are.
I guess just one of the things that's really special about this place is just that you form a family with people that you met 3 days ago, and all of a sudden they're, people that you find genuine love for. And that, I think, is just a really special thing that you don't find in many places, that I haven't found in any other place other than camp. So I guess that's one of my favorite things about this place.
Your top 10 queen, your program and logistics coordinator, Jordan!
When I first started out at camp in 2006, I did not have a very strong Jewish identity. I went to synagogue and, you know, I did Hebrew school and Sunday school, and I was from a very Jewish district in Cincinnati, but I still never had that strong Jewish identity. So coming to camp really changed that for me. I think it's very special and unique to have a place where Jews can come together and not only celebrate their religion, but celebrate the culture as well. And besides that, it's so much more than the religion. It truly goes beyond that. I mean, something about camp is just so special, and everyone is just so unique in their own ways, but we bond together so well.
Camp holds a very special place in my heart. I spent my childhood here. Went through Golan, went through Masada, went through Halitzim, I did AU, I was in Mahon, and I was on staff, and it definitely shaped me into the person that I am today. I have my Jewish values that I learned from Camp Livingston. I have appreciation for my Jewish identity from Camp Livingston. A lot of my lifelong friends I met here at Camp Livingston, and it gave me confidence. It gave me a sense of pride. Yeah, it gave me a home away from home. And, you know, every year during the school year, I just was counting down the days so I could come back to camp.
So this is my sixth summer, but I've also worked at other camps. I've worked at two other camps, and the joy of watching the kids grow and really the independence that the kids learn is what brings me back to camping. This camp itself has been a huge welcoming environment. Not all the other camps have been, and this has been the most accepting of everybody and everyone's differences, and just been such a friendly place, an amazing place to be.
I remember as a hadracha, I wanted to do the talent show, and it was my second week actually being on camp and experiencing daily camp life. And my cabin mates supported me as I did stand-up comedy for the talent show. And it was not good. And, like, everyone was okay with it because it was just camp, and they were happy that I was trying something new.
So as the ropes director, I kind of take it upon myself to get kids to kind of go out of their comfort zone a little bit, especially on the high ropes course, but also on the low ropes course. So we do a lot of like team building stuff and things that really kind of push people out of their comfort zone and get them into their stretch zone, which is what we call it when they just really kind of come out of their shell a little bit.
So right now I am a counselor for the unit of AU. AU stands for Adventures Unlimited. When we go out on these trips, these kids encounter things that they probably have never encountered before. And a lot of these things are scary. And what we want to do is we want to just give them, as the AU counselor, we just want to give them that push. We want them to know it's okay that you're scared, but also we're here to support you. And we're here to hopefully try to make you overcome something that you would have never overcome without this program.
I've definitely learned how to deal with things that upset me. When I was younger, I was like terrified of all the bugs. And I would just like throw like the counselors, the hachika, my cabin mates, and like the other campers have just like taught me how to deal with things that maybe like scare me. Like if I was afraid of the dark or doing like high ropes and I was like afraid of heights. And it just like I grew as a person just by conquering fears.
All right, congratulations. You, the six of you, you are the 2018 Second Session Maccabiah captains.
It's you.
Congratulations.
Really, Second Session captain?
Yeah.
So, oh yeah, Zach.
We're gonna go over some stuff in a bit, but let's tell you your code. So if anyone will please stand up and close your eyes.
Stand up. Close your eyes.
Close your eyes. Close your eyes.
We're gonna put you back to yourself. Close your eyes. Don't cheat. It's not focused. On the count of three, open your eyes and turn around. One, two, three.
I'm going to count to three. When I reach three, I will have to cry the two of your ears to whoever you want to. But when I reach three, you will open your eyes and stand up and blurt out one of the deepest secrets that you know. One of the deepest secrets that you know on the count of three. You will open your eyes, stand up, and blurt out a secret. A deep secret required in you know. One, two, and three. Open your eyes.
I have two favorite traditions. One is Maccabiah, because I'm competitive at heart, and I love seeing the Ruach that everyone can bring. I know some people are really split on Maccabiah, but I have loved it ever since day one. I won my first year as a camper, 2006, second session, White Rabbits. The theme was Alice in Wonderland, and it got me hooked. That win just like, it sent me going.
So as a camper, I honestly didn't really care about Maccabiah that much. Like, I had fun during it, but I wasn't crazy about it, but I also didn't hate it. It was just, like, normal camp activity that we did, and I was just, like, excited for, like, all other camp activities. And then it wasn't until Hadraha that I started realizing, like, all of what goes into Maccabiah. And even as Hadraha, we wrote the Yetzirah, and we helped a lot with cheers and all of that, and I realized that there's a lot more that goes into Maccabiah than just jumping up and down.
When I was a camper, when I was really young, I remember liking Maccabiah a lot, but didn't really know what it was about. I thought that we cheered for a couple days, but wasn't important to me. And then when I was probably Masada, Grant Kazin, he was talking to us before we went in for our final cheer, and he told us just an amazing, inspiring speech. I don't remember what he said, but he pulled out a necklace and said, "My captain gave this to me when we won, and it made me feel amazing." And that feeling he talked about and the feeling he said he would have and we saw him have when they won that year, it was just the best thing in the world. And ever since then, that's what got me into Maccabia.
Each team is allowed to send 5 campers and 1 staff member to the Art Pagoda. The Art Pagoda has everything out. You shouldn't need to go into the shed. Please leave the Art Pagoda as clean as you found it. If we go down there and we see that there's a whole lot of stuff out, we will deduct points from teams. Because that creates just so much work.
All right, we're gonna go ahead and head into our A-field events for the day.
On the soccer field is green versus blue. And the first matchup on the softball diamond is red versus green. All right, you guys can now go.
And don't forget your washes on!
My Maccabia pass is interesting. My first year, I was on the blue Nestle Crunch, 2009 first session, and we actually won Maccabia, so it started off great. It was a great introduction to Maccabia. I loved everything about it, the competition, the yelling, the screaming. It was definitely for me. Yeah, Maccabia has been, throughout the years, has been awesome for me. I love just getting into it and just having fun and having some friendly competition. And I think the more that the counselors get into it, the more that the kids can get into it and appreciate it. And that's why it's such a special thing at camp, and that's why people like talk about it and keep records of it and have some of their best memories from camp from Maccabia. So I'm definitely a big fan of it. Oh!
Day 1. First full day. Capture the flag. I just got out.
Stay out.
I'm in jail now. We're in jail.
Split up.
Chain it. Yep. All right, let's lay down.
I'm so sad.
Hey, help me, help me, help
me. You
better stay. Nice.
We're back in, baby. Let's go get the flag.
I like to stay on defense and wait for my opposing team's jail to build up. So, like, Blue had a really long jail earlier. And we tried to attack. We weren't successful, but eventually it'll work. We can't afford to not have defense, or else we will lose. It's that simple. So once Blue is down some men in the jail, we'll go ahead and attempt to steal their flag.
Let's
go. How's it feel?
It's great. Camp the Flag's a classic Livingston event. Me and Brandon live for this, so let's go.
We are Red Fire.
2018 second session. So far my experience as a captain has been everything I could have asked for. My first year was 2010 and I had no idea what Maccabia was, and I ended up winning. Came back the next year and wasn't on a good team but had so much fun with it. And I won again in 2012, and that was my last one as a camper. And the night I won in 2012, I told myself that I would come back to be a counselor and I would be a captain. So it really is a dream come true. And I've had so much fun leading these kids the past 2 days. And I really hope I can make them even happier tonight.
For me, Maccabia is, first of all, a great event. And I really love to see kids stretching their limits and pushing a little bit more. And if it's in sports, if it's in cheering, if it's just doing a playing, feeling a little bit uncomfortable, but it's fine to feel uncomfortable and attack your weak points. So I'm just so glad to see all the kids opening more, learning more, and becoming much more mature and more amazing people as they were before.
So I didn't really get to go to camp here. I never experienced Maccabia as a child. And just watching Maccabia, participating in it as a hadacha, and watching it from afar, mostly as a staff, it's always been kind of this looming thought, a goal to reach for, to be a captain. And I've always thought of myself as kind of a leader, But in the positions I was initially at here at camp in the kitchen, I couldn't really do that. And as I've kind of grown into a leader here at camp, I kind of saw this idea coming into fruition of being a Maccabi captain. So I do it for the kids. I wish I could have had what these kids had. And that's why I do this. It's for the kids, because it's something I never had.
Maccabi is something that I definitely always enjoyed. I went to a day camp growing up that actually had a much smaller Maccabi and loved it there. Was even a captain of a team before I was even a camper here, which was kind of cool. So I came in like thinking that I knew everything that was going to happen, and was just like very wrong. But I always loved Maccabi as a camper. I wasn't the type of person to like get up and lead cheers, but I was. I just loved participating in them, and I loved the events. I'm not a super competitive person by any means, but I really love the competition of Maccabi because it's all good spirited, and like you can still really give it your all.
It's honestly so much more than the competition and winning and being first in line for ice cream, but it's the fact that a group of 150 people can block out the rest of the world and block out everything wrong, and they can become so concentrated on one goal, which is winning, but like doing it as a united front, it's the coolest feeling in the world.
Maccabi was a time where camp came together and there was just so much ruach and so much fun to be had. As a camper, I loved finding out the cheers, finding out the breaks, and just being able to support and help my team. And I loved being able to participate. And one time I was in the dance gauntlet, I remember, for like 12 minutes, and my team was just screaming my name. And it was one of my best memories at camp.
I think what really sparked my interest into wanting to be a captain was talking to a guy by the name of Victor Commissar, who was my Hydrocal director and who had been at camp many years before that. He loved Maccabi, and he always, you know, he really gave me a good understanding of what it was all about. Because a lot of people come into the whole captain idea or like Maccabi itself and think that the objective is to win, which it definitely is. But at the same time, he kind of helped me realize that the objective is to really just make sure that everybody's having a good time. And I thought that that was something that I would be really good at, because especially with campers, I like making sure that they have a good time.
One of my role models as a camper, especially in Maccabi, was Rafi Goldfarb. He was my captain 2011 second session. We were the Blue Hurricanes. And then he ended up being my captain the next year. I was a camper captain. We were Green Athena. And his energy level and the way he dealt with the kids in certain situations and made sure everyone knew that they were doing a great job and they were participating a perfect amount. And even if they didn't want to, he always found a way for the kids to feel accepted in that event. And I look up to him in so many ways, and one of the main ways is as a Maccabi captain.
Honestly, I think it's pretty close everywhere. I think red and green might be a little bit in front of blue, but I honestly have no idea. Whoever has an idea. So that's the beauty of Maccabi, right? You cheer and scream and sweat and fight and work hard, all in the hopes of being able to eat the ice cream first and for the captain to see your captains blow out the candlelight. So that's what makes it so special, and we will see tonight who wins.
Hopefully. I need my second dub, please. Thank you.
My favorite tradition at camp, I love Maccabi, so I'm gonna go with the Maccabi candle pass, because it's like a penalty shootout in the World Cup final. Like, any team can win. I mean, even though you may think that you didn't win, there's still a chance that your captains blow that candle out, and you never know if that actually will happen until it actually happens. So it's just the most nerve-wracking thing, and it's just absurd for everyone in the room to, you know, get chills waiting or like hoping that this is the time when the candle goes up, and then they are passing it, and then finally, when that one person blows it out, those two people blow it out. It's just like, holy cow. I just won Maccabi.
Green, come back to Earth.
Ladies and gentlemen, Camp Livingston, May I have your attention to the front of the Chador? Right now is the start of your journey to the Wall of Fame. If you are interested in being a part of this year's Gaga tournament, please come up front. We're gonna start with Golan. If you're not in Golan, sit down. Golan first, come sign up for the Gaga tournament. I will call each unit one at a time. Thank you very much.
Who's gonna win?
Jack Reiserman. Jack Reiserman.
Who's winning it all?
Jack Reiserman.
Jack. Not me now. Jack. Grant.
No, Alex Schwartz.
Is this the year? Are you gonna win?
Let's do it. Who's he
actually? Yeah.
Theo's kind of good.
I think Theo should be a 5, and I want Lindsay.
No, Lindsay, I think Tessa should be a 6.
Dude, it's the Michael match.
Dude, who cares about that?
It's so funny.
I think Tessa should be a 6, and Theo should be a 5.
How good is Shayna? Shayna's pretty good, actually. Yeah?
Yeah, I feel like she's overrated. Like, I don't think she can really.
Yeah, that's good.
Sounds like Emily Hawaii 5-0 Wasserstrom.
Yes.
Also, technically, I try to think of something, but she only plays the ukulele, and technically the ukulele come from Hawaii. So, Emily Hawaii 5-0.
Every nickname has to have meaning.
And she played the ukulele, and it came from Hawaii.
This is stupid, they don't have a meaning to it.
No, she has a meaning.
She has a meaning, I just...
Hawaii 5-0.
She only plays the ukulele, and the ukulele comes from Hawaii.
What?
West Turner.
Yeah, oh,
yeah.
Oh, T-R-N. Oh,
Brandon.
T-R-N. Yes, that's what
and
we're doing.
And why are you adamant?
Because there's a word
in
it.
Why
are you
adamant?
Because there's a word in it.
But why does that matter?
It's a name.
Because
it's a name.
His name is a word.
His name is
ERN.
ERN
is not a word.
Welcome to the 2018 second session Gaga Tournament Selection Show! We have an amazing tournament planned ahead of us. Before we begin, I'd like to mention the themes for this tournament in the region specifically. This tournament is a cheese meals themed tournament. Meaning that the four regions are the baked potato region, the pizza bagel region, the grilled cheese region, and last but not least, the quesadilla region. All right, to start us off in the baked potato region, the 5-4 matchup, a 5-seed Shayna, Mir, will be playing the 4-seed Lindsay Baller Ruskin. Yeah! And the 8-seed playing game will be Liam, better late than never, Asadi, versus the 8-seed Gabby, lying is no way to build, Kevin Truss Crawford. The winner of that 8-seed playing game will play the overall number 1-seed, Jack, the South will rise in rank.
Who's excited? Yeah.
Our first judge is none other than your A-field director from Indiana University, Mr. Zach Horowitz. Right over here, we see Brandon Noodles Nathanson. On the Ohio State post is Joshua Seth Russell, going to the Ohio State University. Also from the Ohio State University, hailing from Cincinnati, Ohio, is Mr. Jack O'Loon. From Miami University, love and honor, Jordan Schneider. From Indiana University, we have William Coleman. Emma Cohen.
You're the ball boy.
Okay.
And the ball boy.
And who's our ball boy today?
Noah.
Mr. Noah Pelbert is our ball boy today.
Oh.
With all this being said,
talk to him.
Where am I going?
It brings me great honor, great pleasure, and it is just so joyful to be announcing this Gaga tournament. But it wouldn't be the same without somebody else. Somebody who right now is just not here. Or he is here, but not right now. He's always in our hearts, and this year he retired. But rumor has it that he might be coming out of retirement for this very Gaga tournament. Ladies and gentlemen, hailing from the beautiful city of St. Louis, Missouri, Mr. Scott Hunter Prywitz.
Go hard or go home. Daniel Bobblehead Cooper, now
your
chance to roam.
Yes,
go hard or go home. Theo, Croatian representation, go. Now is your chance to roam. This game is the best of one.
Over here, Daniel. Camp Livingston wall and the pit wall.
Over here. Playing games, round 32 and 216 are out of one. Winner advances. This game is win or go home. Theo, are you ready? Daniel, are you ready? Judges, are we ready?
Oh.
God.
Ladies and gentlemen, words cannot.
Oh.
And it looks like we have the first call.
That is 3 outs out of 5. Theo, you are out.
So with that, the first game of the tournament has come to a close.
Pelbert! Where's Pelbert?
Like I said, ladies and gentlemen.
If I gotta do that one more time, we're finding somebody else, Pelbert.
I like the combination between skill and strength. Like, you don't have to be the strongest, the tallest, or like the fastest person to like win or be really good at Gaga. You have to have a great strategy, great touch. My favorite Gaga player. I think it'd be Sam Aganoff, just because I've heard a lot about how good he was, and he won 3 whole tournaments at Camp Livingston, which has been done by only a few people.
My first year at camp in 2010, Gaga was a pretty big deal because there was a lot of athletic kids who were campers during that time, and what does any athletic kid want to do is be good at Gaga and be better than everyone. And so I, like many others, tried my best in Gaga. I was, like, as a Golaner, not really that good, but it was fun to play in the Bay Dom with, like, wooden benches, and then people would, like, come in and kind of, cut off the pin in half, and it was kind of fun. And I remember there was holes in the wall of the Bay Dom because people would hit hard, and it was just, like, fun, and I just remember hearing about the Gaga tournament, but, you know, I wasn't staying 4 weeks, so it didn't really matter to me. My second year, definitely focused more on Gaga, but was still pretty bad. I like got out like in a cabin of eight. I probably came sixth in my cabin tournament. But like was in the tournament for the first time. I was pretty happy. I got to be in a play-in game. I was an eight seed, lost to a nine seed, Go Lawner. Was really devastated. It was the first game of the tournament. I thought it was gonna, I was gonna win the tournament even though I was terrible, but I was pretty devastated after losing. And I probably should have won it, but that kid, Nick Corey, ended up losing to Sam Agronoff in the next round, which would have been really cool, I think, if I got to play Sam. And I recently met Nick Corey a year ago and did a service trip with him, and we talked about it and laughed it off, and that dude did not care about Gaga at all, and I cannot believe I didn't beat him.
So my first year in 2014, first session, I was a two seed as a second year Golaner and got to the finals against Ryan. He beat me though. I was a little mad, but it's okay. Ryan's really good. And that was first session, and I switched to second session. I've been going second session ever since. And my second year, I was a four seed because there was a lot of great players that year.
And then 2013 came along. I'd skipped 2012 at camp for a lot of reasons, but I regret it now. But 2013 in Holocene, definitely focused a lot more on Gaga. I mean, the older kids who were really good, like Sam, Dylan, and Brandon, were all gone, so the Gaga tournament was a little open. No one was necessarily like, oh, I'm, Josh, you're gonna win the Gaga tournament, you're a favorite. Alec Blyer's a really good player, Jet's a really good player, Jonathan Klein's a really good player. But I just took it seriously, tried my best. Wasn't really that big of a kid, so I played really defensively. The Gaga tournament came around, and I ended up being in the final against Kevin. It took about 8 minutes, and finally I won. And I was like, oh, okay, now we're going. I'm probably gonna be one seed, became one seed. And then I was just like, you know what? I need to win a game in the tournament, because if I don't win a game, just like last time, I lose a game, I'm out. Like, the first game's all that matters, and then we'll see how far I go. Tournament ended up going in my favor a little bit. Win the first game was like, holy cow, calmed down a lot. Was able to like take a deep breath, but still just focused a lot and tried my best. Had a little bit of favorable matchups. Lucky that Brandon Blyer beat Alec in the Elite Eight, that I was able to beat Brandon. I played like two girls in the way, but when it was time, I knew what I had to do and got it done, made it to the final, and I was against Kevin again. And just like the Kevin tournament, took like 8 minutes every game, was really defensive. Everyone was probably like, these two kids are terrible at Gaga, but to us, we were both like, holy cow, this is the coolest thing we've ever done in our life. We're in the final right now. Ended up going to game six. Like, I probably won in game six, but it's okay, because I ended up winning in game seven. And it was pretty awesome. My brother ran in, everyone ran in. I was like, holy cow, I'm just like Sam Agronoff. And I remembered like 2 years before in 2011, I had this like journal that in my room that I never used. Never used at all. But like one day I was like really bored before camp, and like I wrote on the wall like 2010 and like the winners, and like it was like Sam Agronoff 2012, and then like 2013 I wrote Jay Russell, and that ended up happening, and I went home and I thought that was pretty damn cool.
Yeah, Gabby!
Ladies and gentlemen, this is it, Max. This is it. I have seen the pyramids of Egypt. I have been to the Great Wall of China. But oh boy, have I never seen something like this. Let's go!
Okay, we're gonna go ahead and get started. Welcome back. We're gonna resume at the Elite Eight. Keep in mind that matchups are now 2 out of 3 to advance. You need 2 wins in order to advance. All right, let's go ahead and get started.
Concluding the big, big potato region.
Wow.
Big potato.
And back to Kato.
Thank you.
The one seed, Jack, the South Bowl Risemen. Welcome to Elite Eight. It's time to see if it's luck or if it's fate. Versus the two seed, Jordan, Fast and Furious Hall.
Let's
go, Jack.
God's Plan Hall. Welcome to Elite Eight. It's time to see if it's luck or if it's fate.
Judges, are you ready? Max Torum, are you ready?
Oh, yeah!
All right, Lemon Check.
Jordan, are you ready? Jack, are you ready?
Interesting thing. Derek Jeter won that game just like he won our hearts.
Alex, that's pretty
cool.
Many
times. You.
Spin it. Hey, twist it. In the dirt.
You can't catch it.
Camp Livingston, I shine.
Twist it in the dirt.
You.
This is a textbook David versus Goliath story, I think.
They kind of look alike.
Yeah, they kind of do. I do, you know? All
right, we ready?
I think we're ready to go.
Back. The South Bowl Rising Men. Welcome to the championship game. Will it be your name on the Wall of Fame?
Again.
Let's go, Isaac.
Isaac.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are here. All the hard work, all the devotion, all the emotion.
For those who do not hear, this is a best of seven.
All the blood, sweat, and tears that have gone into this tournament. It's already here. Whose name will be on that wall? Will it be Sir Isaac Levitch or Mr. Jack Risen?
That's five.
I guarantee that to you.
I saw blocking it.
Yeah.
No, it hit.
Okay, Jack leads 1-0. All right, guys. Jack leads 3-0. Isaac, you win or you go home. Jack, you win. Your name goes on the wall again. Isaac, are you ready? Jack, are you ready? Judges, are we ready?
Woo!
Game four.
Congratulations, Jack. You have a
ladies
and gentlemen, oh, now it's the time to thank all of you. And then we come back here and join our love. And
All right, quick question. Who wants to tie the senior staff? All
right.
Don't break my nerves.
I will.
Please do.
I know.
You get to find me in the face? I'm gonna find Max in the face. Mark my words, I'm gonna find Max in the face.
Find the big man, Mr. Max
Hampton.
Yeah. We have Tova!
Yeah!
2, 3!
Bit of a tricky question. One of my favorite traditions at camp, I would probably say it definitely would not be Macabre for me personally, but I think Livingstock is a great tradition to have here. Personally, I like it because it's short and sweet.
I think my favorite tradition is Livingstock, probably. I think it's really cool that there's a variety of different games and dancing, and all the kids get super into it. They all dress up in tie-dye. It's one of the one events I think at camp that everyone truly gets really into it, and it's just like a fun cap to the summer. I feel like it's kind of the point where people are getting tired and stuff, and so by having it the third week of camp, it kind of boosts spirits, and it's really fun to enjoy and just hang out with everyone, and even having midnight breakfast, which is a cool thing that you only get to do here. And I think that Livingstock is really special and unique to Livingston, and that's one of the things that makes this place really special, and that we can create things that only happen here.
I'm gonna sing Don't Look Back in Anger. Will and Scott are gonna sing It's by Oasis. It's like the other, it's one of the other three known songs besides Wonderwall.
What's the other one?
Champagne Supernova.
Yeah.
Ticket to Ride, Will and Scott are going to sing. Then we have Great Escape.
Throw it away, forget
Chili Peppers.
Oh, I know that song.
Really have Chili Peppers. And then
what should do?
Dirty Little Secret.
We'll do Let's Do Californication.
Yeah.
Oh!
That's so dramatic.
I would sing anything. I'll sing anything that's like not too high.
You're gonna look on the ground. If you see a piece of trash, you're gonna throw it in the garbage can that's standing right behind Sam. Sam, point to the garbage can. Boom, right there. Then, you are going to slowly, by your unit, when I call you, proceed to the Hadar, where we will have some midnight breakfast.
We just ended the World Series on a strikeout.
I'm
upset.
Hi, ladies. Great game. Go ahead and shake hands.
Congratulations, Zaharia.
Woo! Good job.
We got 4 days until the end of camp. Just had the Women's World Series game. Kfar Saba versus Naharia. Kfar Saba got absolutely destroyed. Naharia won 17-4. It was a good battle nonetheless. Good game, but really looking forward to this men's softball game that's about to happen. Two great teams, Jericho and Hertzler, are about to square off. And, you know, we'll see what happens. First session this summer, one of the most amazing comebacks I've ever seen on Goldberg Field happened, and it was really something beautiful to watch. Can't wait for it, and I'm excited to see what happens.
Welcome to the World Series. You've earned your place here in this game today, and I wish you all the best of luck.
You played one game.
I need one captain from each team, and we'll decide who's home and who's away. All right, Public, I'm going to throw this to you, and I want you to catch it like that. Oh, catch it down, man. Hand it up. Oof, oof. Who's it going to be? Homer away.
Him? Oh. He got that?
Yes.
Yeah, Homer away. Oh.
Oh. That's okay. It, boys. Right,
here goes home.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's
act like you're crying for me.
Whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched.
No, but for real, let's go out, have some fun. Hey, let's what's up? Let's have some fun. Let's play hard. Let's respect our opponents, all right? And
let's win us a series.
Yeah, let's go. Let's go win us a championship. All right, let's go. Hey, I got Jarek on three, Jeter's on six. 1, 2, 3.
Jarek
on
5, 6. Jeter.
Tiny Black wearing black at bat. Oh, huge pop up and Adam Pelver with the catch. That'll do it, folks.
F-T-K.
We are going
F-T-K.
Into the bottom of the first.
No, this is not FTK. You played a win. 100%.
Taking the field includes Alex Sloppy Fish Blyer.
Floppy, flap, flap, flap.
Strong top of the inning.
Yeah.
How about that cast?
How about that top of the inning? Now, rolling in to the bottom of the first, we have Hertzley at bat. Specifically, Levi Kobe.
On your marks. Get set. Go!
All right.
Oh my gosh. Avi, that's what it is. Johnny. Come out. Oh, Johnny tripping Avi. Oh, tripped Avi again. Avi's going around. A little, that's a little. Oh, he's coming with the hat, and it is Johnny! He's also ready.
anybody for some caving? You can do some spelunking and knee pads. It is over.
Great game,
the men are on the lines.
Congratulations, Rena.
Signing off. Scoba, Rena, RIP Mindy.
I think something that the kids look forward to, and it's something that I really, really look forward to, was the just the enjoyment of playing the game, the thrill that it brings to you, and you know, win or lose, you're learning something. You know, if you lose, you're learning how to grow, you're learning how to change, and change with the cabin, develop with the cabin, and you're really learning to become best friends with the people that you're playing with, and it's a pretty amazing thing, and I think that goes for every activity, sport, you name it, that we have at this camp. It brings you closer, and it brings you together, so I think that's something the kids look forward to, and it's definitely something that I look forward to as a camper.
After dinner, we're going to have an exciting song session, followed by Israeli dancing.
This group, no one walking passes us. You stay in front of us at all times.
Friday night's really special here. The Shabbat process is incredible. It starts out, everyone, you know, we get 2 hours for everyone to dress up nice. You look your best. Everyone's looking good. We meet at the menorah for pictures. We walk arm in arm to the chadar singing Bim Bam. Then we continue with song session and Israeli dancing, of course. And the most amazing part of the night is services at the menorah. It's dark. We light it, and everyone's sitting right in front, and I get to be, you know, standing up in front of everyone.
I'm going to be playing this next song. I'm going to call up someone very special to Camp Livingston history. The song leader from 2006 and 7, maybe 2005, Joey's brother, D. Hyde.
Wow, this is awesome. Thank you so much for having me. So, who knows the song He Nay Rock Heaven? You want to form some strings around this guitar?
Yeah.
It's the final day here at Camp Livingston. We're about to have our friendship circle. We're gonna sing a couple songs. People are gonna cry, people are gonna hug, and kids are gonna be on their way. And the summer will be officially over. Summer 2018 will be in the books. I haven't cried yet, but I bet in 5 minutes when you check in with me, I won't be able to talk, so.
As your time at camp fades, and these grounds make way for a new generation of Livingstonians, you are reminded of the memories that brought you back each and every summer. The place, and more importantly, the people, are what make the camp experience worthwhile. At camp, we all share a common ground on one truth. The truth that camp is our home. The home we all arrived at for the first time. The home where we learned to grow. The home we cherished for the many years we were blessed with. The home we left for the final time. And the home we have for a lifetime. When our time comes, each and every one of us will fly away. Our footsteps will fade away. And we will die away. Keep the flame burning as long as you can. Leave everything you have for the next generation. And when your time comes, fly away and die away. You can carry me through. Oh, give me the
speed for me. Fuck, it's Mindy!
Mindy! Come here, I know.
Drops in my eye, country roads, take me home to the place where I belong. Camp Livingston, Bennington, Indiana,
belong. Can't lose it.
West Virginia, Blue Ridge Mountains.
So everything in my life up to this point, every part of my being, I can attribute to camp. Without camp, I wouldn't be the same person I am sitting in this chair today. Camp means so much to me. Words, honestly, and I know this sounds cliche, words just can't describe it. If you would have asked me 10 years ago, no, maybe even 5 years ago, if I would be here today, sitting in this chair, doing this interview, I would think you're insane. Anyways, I came back from my Hadracha. I skipped Israel, went with a different program. And during Hadracha, I realized that this place is very important for a lot of people. And a large part of the reason why I come back is because it's something that I never had. Growing up, I wish I could have gone here. This place is very important. And part of the reason why I come back is because to give these kids something that I never had.
Voice in the morning hour, she calls me. The radio reminds me of my home far away. And driving down the road, I get a feeling that I
unfortunately, next year, I'm probably going to have to move on with various things in my life that I would like to take a part in. It's not that I'm not moving on because of anything negative from camp. Like I said before, camp has given me everything, and I owe Camp Livingston so much. I am like forever indebted to this place. But you know, I think it's time to move on, and I'm okay with that. I'm okay with the fact that I won't be here anymore. I'm okay with the fact that I won't be able to see people that I usually have been seeing every year. But hopefully, I know deep down that camp, like always, will have a special place in my heart.
I don't know if my journey at camp will ever end. I think that there will come a time where I'm not gonna be here every summer. However, in the future, I plan on helping as much as I can in the off season. I plan on donating when I'm older. And I plan on having my kids come here. So I'm not sure that my journey will ever end with camp, because camp is truly a part of who I am, and I think it's made me the person that I am. And without camp, I really have no idea where I would be. So I don't think my journey here will ever end. My journey at camp ends when I'm physically and physically unable to come back. Like, I'll always keep coming back to this place as long as I can, even if it requires time off or I get emotional because I can never imagine not coming back. Damn that. Yeah. Hell yeah. I'll be back till I can't come back. Yeah.
This is your home, isn't it?
Yeah, this has been the place that has been my home. Even when I was moving around a lot as a kid, this was the one sturdy place.
I mentioned how in my song, Livingston, I Love You, Spencer's song, whatever you want to call it, that we play at Campfire, it says, there's a line that says, come back as long as you possibly can, as if only to show yourself what life really means.
My plan for the future is an interesting one because I don't know what my exact plans are. Every time I say I'm not coming back, and that this is my last summer, I end up coming back. Every time I say yes, I'll be back next year, something happens and I have to take some time off. So it really is, I never really like to discuss my future here at camp anymore. I just say, we'll see what happens. I'm hoping to be here a few more years. I want to get my 8-year windbreaker, so that's what I'm hoping for.
I mean, I will always have a connection with camp. It's not like I won't ever stop in the sense that I won't stop supporting camp. There's going to be a time, I would say within the next year or two, where I'm going to have to stop coming back as a staff member. Doesn't mean I can't support it as an alumni. I'll be supporting and visiting and coming back every single year, probably, as long as I can. So I wouldn't really say it's stopping. I would just say it's ending my physical presence at Camp Livingston, but that doesn't mean I won't be supporting it in other ways.
So, physically, my journey ends right now. This is my last year at camp. Although I would like to come back, I'm unable to. Graduate school and my future career are taking precedence over camp. And as sad as that is, that's honestly just a part of life. It's part of the cycle. So like I said, physically my journey ends here, but mentally and emotionally and spiritually, my journey with Livingston will continue until I die.
First of all, I'd like to thank my older brother, Arthur Kurtzman. He came here from 2003 to 2007, and he's the one who first brought me to camp, so I guess I have that to be grateful for. Second, I'd like to thank Abby Solomon. She was in my brother's age group. They've been friends since he started coming here. And she's one of the first people I remember meeting in 2007. And she's been with me ever since. She was my unit head in 2011 and then assistant director for the past 2 years. And she's just done a great job. She's so passionate about this place. And it's really nice to see people who are willing to give their all for Camp Livingston. Third, I'd like to thank Rafi Goldfarb. He was my counselor in 2010. He has had such an impact on me. He's actually one of the main reasons that I have one of my major passions today, which is the game of bridge. He taught me that while he was my counselor in 2010, and I'm still playing that very regularly today. He's one of the most fun-loving, energetic, greatest counselors I've ever seen, and Camp will miss him, but he had such an impact on many people who came here. Fourth, I'd like to thank AU13, Israel 14, Hadrachah 15 for being the greatest age group this camp has ever seen. So many just awesome people that I've had the pleasure to spend the last 11 years with. Just love them to death. And I hope that I can stay friends with most of them for years to come. And last, I'd like to thank Zach Horowitz for giving his all for this camp, putting the last 12 years of his life into this place, making this video, and doing everything else he can for this place. Because I know he loves it, I love it, and it's gonna be very different once he's gone, but I know he's had quite an impact, and I thank him for it.
I would like to thank everyone for the reasons, you know, why I've returned. It's not just one person. It's 100% every single person who has a part to play in Camp Livingston. It's not the people that you see here throughout the summer. It's the people that, you know, are behind the off season, working hard to make sure camp that is running. Because I know how difficult that can be for the board members. Also, you know, the people in the office that aren't on camp during the summer. But everyone that plays a part, the campers, the staff, without every single person there that works and dedicates themselves to this camp, you know, this camp wouldn't be. So it could be a farmer's field in southern Indiana, but it's not. It's Camp Livingston, and that's thanks to all of you.
The first person I'd like to thank is Victor Commissar. He was my counselor in 2009 when I was a first-year HOD teamer, and he was my HODRA unit head. And he taught me a lot about myself, especially during HODRA, about being yourself, how to basically grow up and be an adult, but also still have fun with everything, not taking things too seriously. He was a role model when I was a camper, and he was an even better role model when I was a HODRA with him, and I'm forever grateful for him being here. I'm also thankful for Aaron Slavin, because I feel like Aaron had been a constant at camp for me. Every single year I was here, he was here, whether he was a counselor or a unit head, assistant director, director. He was always that one person that was there, was present, made me laugh, was one of my good friends. And I mean, can't thank him more for all the stuff he's done for Camp Livingston. I'd also like to thank my brother, Scott Rywich, for the same thing. He has always been a constant in my life, and having him here at camp has been an incredible experience. I know his time here is short as well, but he has grown up with me here, and it's really cool that we got to share this place together. I know some families like to split up their kids for sessions, have one kid go one session and another one go another, but I'm very thankful that my parents sent us both, because we grew up here and we became closer that way.
I want to say thank you to Jody Brin and Shayna Kramer, who were my very first counselors at camp, and who instilled the love of camp in me. On our bunk night that year, as a little 7 or 8 year old, I remember they took us out to the bee field and taught us a song about the moon that I still, I remember to this day. And as a go-along counselor, every bunk night I would teach that to my kids. I see the moon and the moon sees me. And I still think about that a lot. They were really wonderful. And my other thank you goes to Ruthie Myers, who is somebody who I actually grew up with at this camp. We met when we were probably about 10 years old, and we hated each other from day one. Took us a while. It took us up until AU. So what was that, 14, 15 years old before we finally just decided to let go of those grudges, and she's now my best friend in the world. I consider her my sister. She's my family. She always has my back no matter what, and I never would have had that had we not become family here at Livingston. And she is somebody who makes people better, and so I feel very fortunate to have spent so much time so closely with her. She makes me better. Also want to thank Aaron Slavin and Abby Solomon, because I learned so much from working underneath them for 2 years. And you know, kindness and, you know, how to work in this kind of environment and how to just be a good person. And not only that, but I became very good friends with them as well. And that, you know, and I really treasure those friendships. They are very valuable to me and, you know, never would have had those without this place either. So, thank you.
First person I would like to thank is Abby Solomon. She was my counselor in 2010 for second session Chalutzim. It was my second year of Chalutzim. And I would like to thank her for showing me all the wonderful sides of camp and teaching me how to be competitive in a healthy way and just making me laugh when I needed it. And the second person I would like to thank is Victor Commissar. He was my Hadracha unit head in 2013. And he is probably my biggest inspiration at camp. His passion and his love for this place radiates off of him every time he's here. It's really inspiring to see. He taught my peers and I how to be the best counselors we could be, and I'm forever grateful for that. And I am so appreciative of all the love he has given me and the other people in my unit and camp as a whole, and I just want to say thank you.
Thank you to my parents, thank you to my first go-on counselors, thank you to Ruthie and Betsy, thank you to everyone who comes back to Camp Livingston and makes this place special.
My first summer was 2014, and I have to say thank you to the Hadracha, because that year they just welcomed me in and that they're just dear to my heart.
Thank you, Zach Horowitz, Max Hampson, and Abby Solomon.
Thank you to second session, Hadracha 2014.
Thank you, Aaron Slavin, my former roommate and former boss.
Thank you, Lynn and Brett Prywich.
Are you recording?
Yeah.
Are we going?
Yeah, it's recording.
Hi, this is the first video of the movie. I'm very excited to create another movie for camp. I think it's gonna be very exciting, and this is the beginning. It all starts now.
Can I even speak up, please?